and welcome to a guide to water wells, the use, construction, and components of, by the Triage Project at the Michigan Geologic Survey. Do you have well water? Michigan has about 1.25 million private household wells, more than any other state. The total groundwater usage in Michigan is about 700 million gallons per day, and 45% of Michigan citizens rely on groundwater wells. Can you see your well from here? What is groundwater anyways? It's just water that we find in the ground, right? Actually, groundwater is water that soaks into the soil and is stored in the tiny spaces called pores between rocks and particles of soil. Two of the common ways that the groundwater is formed is through precipitation or melting snow and ice. For more information on groundwater, check out our video, What is Groundwater? I've put a link in the description below. How does groundwater form? It's as simple as gravity. Surface water gets pulled downward towards the center of the earth through the spaces in soil and rock until it reaches a confining layer. A confining layer can be something as bedrock or a clay layer. Then it pools, creating an aquifer. For more information on how groundwater flows through the subsurface, see our water tank video. We've put a link in the description. Why is groundwater important? Drinking, crop irrigation, and industry. Also, accessibility. More than 90% of Americans in rural areas rely on groundwater for drinking purposes, which ties in the limiting of diversion of surface water. It is much easier to pull groundwater out than it is to divert a river or a stream into a community. It's also often cleaner than surface water. How do we get groundwater out? We use wells drilled in the earth that tap into aquifers to pull out water. They use a combination of groundwater pressure and a pump to extract the water from below the surface. Although in some cases, the groundwater pressure is so great that the water flows freely above the surface. Wells are generally classified into three different categories. Bored or shallowed wells, which are mostly in sand, and they're dug into unconfined aquifers at depths less than 100 feet. Often constructed where the water table is less than 15 feet below the surface. They are generally low yield and use a large borehole. Unconsolidated wells, the geology typically consists of sand, silt, clay, and gravel. It is deeper than a bored well with a smaller diameter borehole. And finally, consolidated or rock wells, mostly sandstone and shale wells in Michigan. In the lower peninsula, these wells often have large amounts of overburden or glacial drift. Things like sand, silt, clay, gravel, and boulders pushed down by the glaciers. These have an average depth of 250 feet. The well type you'll need depends on the availability of water on your property, your budget, the geology of where the well is placed, and the purpose of the well. In Michigan, there are different classifications based on the purpose of the well. The first is household, which is a private well that serves only one residence and usually averages between 10 and 15 gallons per minute. Public supplies are divided into three types. Type 1 is an in-use year-round and provides water to a minimum of 15 living units or 25 residents. These are municipal wells, mobile home parks, and nursing homes. Type 2 are in use at least 60 days a year and services at least 15 connections or 25 individuals. These are places like schools, gas stations, restaurants, and churches. And finally, the type 3 are simply wells that are not categorized by the first two public well types. Industrial and commercial wells are used for non-drinking industrial purposes like fire protection. And finally, irrigation wells are used for plants, livestock, or elsewhere in agriculture, and not used for drinking purposes. They often have large reservoir tanks to compensate for their low yield sites.
So how are wells constructed? Most wells today are made with different types of drilling rigs. The first and most common in Michigan is rotary drilling. This involves a large spinning drill bit, often with pneumatic or hammering action, that grinds and fractures the underlying geology, pumping it out as it drills deeper. The sediment and broken rock are flushed to the surface with either mud or air. Mud is for drift wells, which is mostly used in the lower peninsula due to more overburden, and air, which is for hard rock wells, which is mostly used in the upper peninsula where geologic formations are closer to the surface. These wells are often deeper than 100 feet, and they are best used for consolidated formations. With the auger method, the spiral augers drill holes in lengths of the auger. The auger along with the sediment are pulled up from the hole where the geology can be identified. Then, sections are added onto the auger to drill deeper. The auger forms large diameter boreholes to compensate for low yield soils. These are shallow wells at less than 100 feet and are best for unconsolidated sediment like sand. These boreholes often collapse under dry conditions, which can make this method difficult. Generally, it is the last resort when other water sources, like a confined aquifer, are inaccessible or unavailable. The cable tool method involves a heavy bit attached to a drill string, raised and dropped continuously, loosening the sediment and breaking up the rocks below. During this process, the sediment and broken rock are flushed out to the surface with high pressure water. This is sometimes called percussion drilling or spudding and is very common in Michigan. It is slower than rotary drilling, but also cheaper. It's best used for shallow, unconsolidated, or soft rock wells at less than 100 feet. There are a couple more construction methods that don't involve drilling rigs and can be done by homeowners themselves. Beginning with dug or bored wells, these are the least common and are hand dug or made with heavy machinery such as a backhoe. Like the auger method, these are large diameter boreholes to compensate for low yield soils, although they are often bigger, around 2 to 3 feet, to act as a reservoir for the water. These are shallow at 10 to 30 feet and are made in unconsolidated sediments. These are cased with building materials such as stone, brick, and tile to prevent the hole from collapse. Typically, they lack continuous casing unlike other methods. These are uncommon due to health concerns and are vulnerable to surface contaminants and drought. The last type is driven wells. These are very common along lakes in Michigan due to thick layers of sand and high water tables. This entails a sharp well point with a screen threaded onto a length of steel casing and hammered into the ground. Driven wells do not require heavy equipment and is overall the cheapest method of well installation. They are typically driven in sand or soft gravel to shallow depths of around 30 to 50 feet. Like other shallow wells, these are potentially vulnerable to surface contamination. For the rest of this video, we're going to explore some common well components, and then I'll go over a few tips for Michigan well owners. So, beginning with the casing, this is the outermost layer of the well. Often made of a hollow steel or plastic cylinder, it is seated inside the borehole to encase the well internals. This stabilizes the borehole, prevents collapse of sediments that can cause clogs, and reduces the likelihood of well contamination. To place the casing, sections of it are sealed together using a variety of techniques. Steel casing is often threaded together, welded, or a combination of the two for an extra tight seal. Threading refers to the machined ridges on the ends of the casing, much like a bolt and nut, that allow the sections to be fastened together. PVC plastic is generally threaded and or glued together. Casing can be placed during or after forming the borehole. Most wells with unconsolidated material require some type of casing to fortify the walls of the borehole and keep the water contaminant free. The main exception being rock wells, which only require casing slightly past the top of the formation to stop the overburden from falling into the well. The two most common types of well casing are steel and PVC plastic. Beginning with steel, it's mainly made from carbon or stainless and is much stronger than PVC. Steel casing is susceptible to corrosion from alkaline or acidic soils and high levels of dissolved solids. Over time, if corrosion is kept unchecked, this can lead to holes in the well's casing and screen, which leave the well vulnerable to contaminants, clogs, and excess sediment in the water. This type of casing is best used for hard rock wells. PVC plastic is much more lightweight and flexible, although it can be damaged more easily. For instance, some grouting methods generate excessive heat that can damage the casing. PVC is easier to install and less expensive than steel, and it is mainly used for unconsolidated material, although it can be used for some rock wells if great care is taken. Now, there are a couple terms you may hear associated with the well casing. First being the drive shoe. This is an extra strong steel fitting attached to the bottom of the casing to improve penetration capability and keep the casing intact. Also, there's the shale packer, or trap. This acts as a support for the grout column above the pumping level and helps seal between the casing and the borehole. Another important part of protecting the well internals is the well grouting. This is used to seal the space between the casing and the surrounding sediment. Like the casing, it prevents surface contaminants from draining into the well and helps to stabilize the borehole. Bentonite clay is the most widely used material in either a dry granular or slurry form. Slurry is used in rotary drilling, while dry granular is used for most other drilling methods. Bentonite clay swells up to 15 times its dry volume when wet, creating a tight seal around the casing. Neat cement is also common for shallow grouting at a depth of 25 feet or less. Necessity and depth of grouting depends on geology. Loose sediment, thin glacial drift, and shallow bedrock wells are prone to contaminant infiltration. Wells consisting of finer sediments like clay and silt, or deep rock wells, are less susceptible to surface contamination. Other benefits and uses of well grouting include preventing the loss of artesian pressure and restricting movement of water between aquifers, adding structural integrity and durability to the casing, as well as protection from corrosion, and lastly, it can be used to abandon wells that do not meet production or water quality requirements. The next component is a very important one. Screens are sections of the well beneath the water table with small openings that allow water to flow in the well. The purpose is to stop the intake of coarse sediments and limit finer sediments. While developing a well, finer sediments near the well are pumped out. This leaves the coarser sediments to act as a partial barrier for the surrounding finer sediments. A slow entrance velocity of water entering the screen at less than 0.1 feet per second is important to keeping the formation intact. Many rock wells or coarse gravel wells don't require a screen. These wells lack the fine sediments at the pumping level that make a screen necessary. Like the casing, the most common materials the screen is made from are steel and PVC plastic. Steel screens are frequently stainless steel wire wrapped. This consists of a thin wire welded around steel rods forming a hollow cylinder. It allows for the most intake per unit area and has the least water level drawdown. It also has the same susceptibility to corrosion as steel casing. Plastic screens are usually PVC slotted. These are PVC pipes with thin slits cut horizontally along the length of the pipe. They have the least amount of open area for intake, and they are best used in soft sediment like clay. Because screens are so important to well performance and water quality, we're going to take a deeper dive into its specifications and fittings. One technique that works in addition to the screen is gravel packing. This is coarse gravel packed around the well. This not only reduces fine sediment intake, but also improves well production and recovery rate by increasing permeability, or ability for water to pass through. Also, it increases the stability of the borehole and prevents sediment collapse. Screens are typically 4 to 5 feet long. Longer screens allow for greater intake and may be used for things like irrigation. Slot numbers indicate opening size to the thousandths of an inch. For example, a number 10 slot is 1/100th of an inch. This number is determined by the particle size of sediments within the aquifer. The goal is to be as large as possible while keeping the gravel pack or formation intact. This filters out sediment while also letting in as much water as possible in as short a period as possible, improving well production. Screens often fall into two categories, telescoped or attached. Telescoped involves lowering the screen to the bottom of the well and then pulling back the casing the length of the screen. This reduces problems from collapsing sediment and allows screens to be replaced without breaking the grout seal. Telescope screens often have two fittings, a neoprene packer, which is attached to the top and seals the area between the casing and screen, and a blank, or sometimes called a rise pipe. This is attached to the top so the entire screen can be exposed out from the bottom of the casing without falling out. The other type is attached, where the screen is attached directly to the bottom of the casing through threading and/or welding. The formation is then intentionally caved in, with or without a gravel pack, to finish setting the screen. Some other important fittings include the Bremer check valve, which maintains pressure in the well when the pump stops and only allows the water to flow in, not out. There's also a bottom plug, which protects sediment from entering the bottom of the screen and helps with ease of installation. Pumps are responsible for extracting the water from the well. There are two main types of pumps used for most water wells. First is the submersible. This is submerged in the well and uses a series of propeller-like blades to push water up through the well to the surface. This pump is best for wells exceeding 100 feet. The other is the jet pump. Placed above the ground, this pump pulls water from the well using suction. Now there are two types of jet pumps, shallow well jet pumps, which have a maximum depth of 25 feet, and deep well jet pumps, which have a maximum depth of around 150 feet. Depending on the quality of the pump and the conditions of the well, a pump can last anywhere between 4 and 20 years for jet pumps and 6 to 15 years for submersible pumps. A major part of the well you may find in your home or on the surface is the pressure tank. This is a tank that holds water from the well and ensures water pressure in the home. It is connected to the pump and allows it to cycle less frequently, increasing its longevity. Now that we've covered all the major parts of a well, there are a couple more things you may hear associated with it. If you hear the term 12 inches above grade, this is referring to the Michigan law that requires the wellhead to terminate at least 12 inches above the ground, as can be seen in the picture. A pitless adapter is essentially frost protection. It attaches to the casing several feet below the grade and diverts water to the home or area of need. To wrap this video up, I'm going to give some important tips for machine well owners. Michigan law requires a minimum well depth of 25 feet. It's important to test your water annually, or if you notice any changes in color, taste, or smell. To test your water, please contact a certified testing lab. Water wells should be inspected annually for damage or possible contamination. Any visible corrosion or cracks on the wellhead, casing, or surrounding grout should be repaired immediately. Keep the area around the well clear if possible, and do not use any pesticides, fertilizer, or any harmful chemicals near the wellhead. Be cautious of possible nearby contaminants. For example, check the integrity of your septic tank. Look out for decreased well performance. Common reasons well performance decreases include a plugged or dry aquifer, organic blockages, mineral buildup, sediment pumping, damaged or corroded casing or screen, and a damaged pump. Decreased well performance could also be due to the age of your well. A typical well is only expected to last about 30 years. If you are experiencing reduced well yield, your system could need rehabilitation. Water well contractors may be able to improve your well's performance through chemical or physical cleaning methods. Over time, some conditions can lead to wells that no longer function properly or are no longer safe to use. When rehabilitation is not an option, the well system must be replaced. This means replacing all the major components of the well or starting a new well in a different location. And that's all we have for you today. Thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, please like and subscribe to the channel. If you want to learn how to find your well using the Michigan State database, click on the link in the description. Also, look out for more of our content if you want to learn about related topics. Take care.